All right, I guess we'll get going. My name is Scott Dillon. I'm the Historic Preservation Review Coordinator for the Vermont Division for Historic Preservation. Quite a mouthful there. But among the many things that we do, we oversee the Lake Champlain Underwater Preserve System, which currently has 9 shipwrecks as part of the preserve system in Vermont and one other site in New York State. About a year and a half ago, we were approached by the Lake Champlain Transportation Company and Jonathan Eddy, representing Waterfront Diving Center, about the potential of adding a new site consisting of one of the Lake Champlain Transportation Company ferries that is reached the end of its useful life as part of the preserve system. And that started a fairly long process of vetting this for all the clear environmental characteristics that we would need to deal with sinking something like that. And we had a task force set up to vet this idea. This public meeting is part, is a culmination of that process. We want to get public comments on this proposal. We've compiled quite a bit of information, which you'll see some of that tonight. It's on the web page at the division, also, I believe, at the Champlain Maritime Museum, some of the background information. Currently, we have applied for a lake encroachment permit from the Vermont Department of Environmental Conservation, and we've also applied for an Army Corps of Engineers permit that are in process. And both of those processes require public meetings such as that, where we can solicit public comment on that. So to get more into the specifics of the project, I'm going to, I guess, turn it over to Jonathan at this point. Okay.
Thanks very much. We envision our part of the presentation, if you will. John Paul, who's port engineer for Lake Champlain Transportation Company, and I have going to kind of tag team the presentation, if you will, and we expect that to take about half an hour, maybe 45 minutes. If at all possible, we'd like to hold questions till the end so we can kind of get through the information. Otherwise, we might be here for weeks, and Officer Friendly over there might not want us here that long, right? So, anyway, for certainly the second half of the meeting, we would like comments, questions, complaints, whatever your thoughts happen to be. As Scott mentioned, the process began actually it was in the summer of 2017 when it first started. The first real organizational meeting, if you will, took place in October of 2017. And that meeting took place at LCT, and present were obviously LCT, Lake Champlain Maritime Museum, the Division for Historic Preservation, the U.S. Coast Guard, Agency of Natural Resources, the Army Corps of Engineers, the City of Burlington, and a cast of thousands. So anyway, it was a good meeting in that we had really the permit type people there that would be making these decisions and guiding us along the way. At the end of that meeting, there was really no negative feedback It was very supportive. There was nobody saying this absolutely can't be done. And based on that, we decided to move forward and work on the information needed for the permit. And this presentation is kind of a culmination of an abbreviated version of what is contained in the permit information. And we did have a second meeting in March of 2019 with some of the same people there. In addition, we had a representative of an organization called Artificial Reef International, which is a company that has done dozens of reefing of boats. And they are really kind of the go-to people for how to do it safely, and how to do it in an environmentally responsible manner. And the representative from the company came up from Florida and presented at the meeting and worked with John and others there to get the ball rolling. So that's kind of a little bit of background of what's gone on. And at this point, I think I'd like to advance one more. At this point, I'm going to turn it over to John, and he's going to talk a little bit about the Addy. We can shut the light off. I just felt kind of a little easier to see. Anybody afraid of the dark?
Yeah. Can people see that all right? At any rate, yeah. At any rate, the Addy was built in Jacksonville, Florida in 1913. And as the South Jacksonville, that was her first name. And she ran there until 1921 between downtown Jacksonville and South Jacksonville. And then in 1921, she moved north. She was renamed Mount Holly and went to Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and operated there from 1921 to 1927 for the Tacony Palmyra Ferry Company. And then a few years later, 1927 and 1936, she ran in New York City. And then in 1937, she returned to Philadelphia. And was actually remodeled. You can see there's a pretty good difference in between this outline and this one. But at any rate, they basically overhauled the superstructure they renamed her the Governor Emerson C. Harrington II. She ran there until 1954. She was steam powered, I think, until about 1946, and they put diesel engines in her at that point. And then in 1954, she was purchased by the Champlain Transportation Company and brought to Vermont. And they renamed her the Adirondack. And she sailed there every season since until September of 2019. It's almost exactly 65 years. Got quite a history, and you know, the vast portion of her history is on Lake Champlain, which is kind of interesting too.
Can everybody hear okay? No.
Okay, a little louder. Okay. The reason that this project has come about is the traffic in Burlington has dwindled over the last 10 or 15 years, and it's gotten to the point where it cannot support three boats anymore. Basically, we're down to one boat service, and the Valcor is a different type of vessel. She's much more of she's got a workboat hull, and she's much more marketable, and plus we can use her as a workboat. So, but the Adirondack really is unfortunately taking up space, and it costs a lot of money to maintain a boat just to keep it, even if you're not using it. It's they require paint and hull work and they're not static things like buildings are. I mean, even buildings are, you know, decomposed, but boats do it multiple times faster. So we looked into a couple of different options. Do you want to get into the options? Or?
Sure.
Yeah.
I'm going to put the next slide up. So the options that were discussed, nobody really wanted the Addy to go away, but with the realization that John described that it was going to have to go away, people said, well, why don't you make a restaurant out of it? Why don't you pull it up on shore and make a museum out of it, kind of like the steamer Ticonderoga down at Shelburne Museum, which is a fabulous thing. Or sell the boat off the lake, at least it would keep it alive, so to speak. And so we looked at different cost estimates for doing those various options. This first one, removing the vessel from the water to create a static display. Again, that the static display without a particular purpose is a little bit difficult to say what it's going to cost to refit the vessel for that purpose. However, just taking the vessel out of the water required two crawler trains, cranes rather. John got an estimate from a crane company, and there are not very many that can do a vessel of this size. It's going to be $1.3 million just to take the Addy out of the water. Okay. Not included in that estimate is site acquisition. Where are you going to put it? Okay. Vessel improvements, what are you going to do to make it a destination or a restaurant or whatever? And ongoing vessel maintenance. Just because it's no longer in the water doesn't mean that the maintenance goes away. Those of you that have followed the Ticonderoga at Shelburne Museum are probably aware that they spent $1.5 million redoing the Ticonderoga in the 1990s. So it's because it's out of the water doesn't mean that there's no money needed. So the feeling is, who's going to have the money to do that type of project? We felt it was very unrealistic. When I say we, it's kind of a collection of the people here, not me, but the people here. Another option was leave the vessel in the water for static use, and that's been done in a lot of places. You see restaurants down in New York City and, you know, and other locales where the restaurants have been, vessels have been converted into restaurants or museums and so on. Estimates involve the cost of doing that, leaving it in the water, in the greater Lake Champlain area, Burlington area, a slip to house the Addy would be around $100,000 a year. And there are not a lot of slips available to be able to do that. She's 152 feet long, mm-hmm. 43 foot in beam.
Yeah.
So it's a big vessel. So we have to have a place to put it if you're looking at that type of thing. Again, you've got some other add-ons that are not included in that annual slip rental. One would be shoreside improvements. You can't just throw the anchor out and put a rowboat out to get to and from the site. So you have to build some type of pier. You have to have pilings driven in order to secure her for weather and also have boarding ramps. So the estimated cost for that was $75,000. And again, it doesn't include vessel improvements. That would vary greatly depending upon the use selected for it. And ongoing vessel maintenance. And this is really a big number when you leave it in the water. The Addy has had, how much of her hull replated?
Probably two-thirds of it.
Two-thirds of her, and there was going to be another, in 3 or 4 years, there's going to be another replating necessary of part that wasn't done, and the estimated cost to do that was $200,000.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, and that doesn't finish the vessel. So again, there's a lot of maintenance, particularly in the water, not to mention the top side. And unfortunately, there are examples of vessels that were turned into other things and left in the water. The other things didn't pan out and the vessel sank. And what happens when a vessel sinks if it hasn't been environmentally clean? There's pollution as a result of oil in the vessel or diesel fuel, grease, and so on. So that is a real bad case scenario. I should mention these figures. I'm up here giving figures. We have the statistics that went into these. These aren't just pulled out of our hat. Okay, we do have, if anybody wants to see them, we can provide them, where these numbers came from, right down to counting how many pilings would have to be driven to secure the vessel. Okay, so there is detail behind these numbers. Selling the Adirondack off the lake is an option. She was built in 1913, and although LCT has maintained her very well over the years, she's still a boat that's over 100 years old. serious maintenance considerations going forward, like the plating I described and so on. So just to get the vessel off of the lake, the estimated cost to do that is about $158,000. She, in order to transport her off the lake, the upper structure would have to be removed to fit under bridges and so on, and also to lighten the load, and she would have to be partially disassembled, and feel free to jump in if I'm making errors
in
my phraseology. He's the port engineer, I'm the flunky. But anyway, the vessel would need to be taken apart and towed down through the canal system down to the Hudson River, and then at that point be reassembled. And the cost, again, to disassemble it, take it down to the Hudson and reassemble it, it's $158,000. That doesn't include the price to buy the ferry, whatever entity is going to buy the ferry. So we felt that these three options aren't really going to fly. As much as we'd like to say, yeah, it'd make a great museum, it's not going to fly given the math involved. So we literally have these last two logical alternatives that LCT has. One is to scrap it. And to scrap it, again, the engines would have to be removed, and there's a lot of work associated with that. One of the problems is the canal, the Champlain Canal, connecting Lake Champlain with the Hudson River, has a 7-foot threshold.
Yeah.
The Addy draws 8 feet. So you can see they have to lighten the vessel to get it to be able to be towed down. So part of the vessel would need to be put on barges in order to get it a shallow enough draft to get it through the canal. So all that's expensive and difficult. Scrapping it, you have the same considerations. It needs to be partially disassembled because it's got to fit through the canal for the reasons I just mentioned. However, it's in Staten Island, the company that...
John Don. Yeah.
They would take the vessel at no charge and cut it up, okay? And LCT could earn a couple of cents a pound or a ton on that scrap value. That would be about $10,000. So the net cost to get the Adirondack scrapped is $64,000. What we're proposing here is $175,000, okay? So for some skeptics that may say, well, you know, LCT wants to do this because it gets the vessel off of their hands and so on. Clearly, their least expensive alternative would be to have it scrapped, which we feel, again, a collective we, feel would be a shame. And that's the reason motivating this project is to save the Addy in the Champlain Valley, although not the way a lot of people think of saving something. But anyway, next slide, wait. The alternative, which Scott already addressed, is to make an underwater preserve out of her, and we can just kind of go through this. She would be the 10th wreck in Vermont waters, the 11th wreck in Lake Champlain. This is a booklet that the State Division for Historic Preservation has put out in the past. They are the administrator of the underwater preserve program. And this was basically public outreach information for divers and other interested people. Wait, if you want to go to the next one. Okay, and this is a little hard to see, but obviously this is Lake Champlain. Again, we're talking about, since this was published, there's been a 10th vessel added, and that is the steamer La Valley in Shelburne Bay. So that was not on this particular document. But in any event, let me do the next slide. We wanted to make a preserve site out of her. She would make a great preserve. There's a lot of history there, as we've already discussed. But from a diving perspective, she's a really neat vessel. And at this point, I'm going to turn it over to John Paul, and he can discuss thoughts.
Well, this is a little hard to see, but hopefully you can at least make out the outlines. The Adirondack, the height from the steel, from the keel to the top of the stack is 43 feet, and basically in the site selection process, we looked at the depth. That was a really important thing. We wanted it, um, we wanted it shallow enough so novice divers could dive on it, but we needed a minimum of 25 feet over the top of the stack so it would never be a problem for navigation. And we found several sites like that. If you can see this, it's really kind of hard to say, but anyway, it's 43 feet from there to there. And so we were looking at a depth of around 70 feet to give us that number, 70 feet at low water. And we found several good sites. The one that we picked has protection from the north wind. It's just about a half mile south of the tip of Lone Rock Point, so it's not too far from the O.J. Walker and the Horse Ferry. It's a soft bottom, but it's a dense soft bottom, which is good. You don't want it to sit on rock because it would just roll over. You want it on something that will actually cradle it. So we're pretty happy with the site. We dove the site a couple of times this summer and probed the bottom just to make sure there was nothing there that could be a problem. But we didn't find anything. So it's a nice big flat area. It has a slight less than 2% slope.
Probably go to the next slide.
Yeah, it's a little easier to see.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Okay. This basically is just a little better drawing. We expect it to settle down into the bottom. You know, it could be 3 feet, it could be 6 feet. We're not absolutely sure of that number, and it may heal over to one side. Probably won't be perfectly upright, but it won't be any more than 30 degrees. And I've been diving on a lot of vessels that are 90 degrees or even more, and they're still great dives. So, and if it does seal over, they'll just increase this distance from the surface to the stack. So that's probably a good thing. Probably go to the next one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Clearly, if we want to make an underwater historic preserve out of a ferry, there are some environmental considerations. The days of taking the boat out, pulling the plug, and let it go down with all the engines on it and all the fuel and so on are long past. That used to be done, but not anymore. So in researching this, there is a document called National Guidance Best Management Practices for Preparing Vessel for Intended to Create Artificial Reefs. This document was put together by the EPA and the U.S. Maritime Administration and about six or eight other alphabet soup organizations. It's a 75-page document which spells out very specifically what needs to be done with a vessel to make it environmentally clean. If you want to read it, I have read it. Feel free to read it. They're actually through the division's website. There is a link in the appendices to this complete document. But in any event, artificial reefs have been in existence, that is vessels sunk intentionally to create reefs or dive sites. The first one was done in 1953, and there have been hundreds and hundreds of them since. Most of those have been in coastal areas, where granted the considerations are a little bit different, but it does give us some good information about tourism benefits, fish habitat, and things like that. There have been three that we highlighted in our application to Agency of Natural Resources that have been done in freshwater in the Northeast. Two of those are in the greater Chicago area. Both of those are very similar in size to the Addy. One was sunk in 2010 and the other 2003. And there is the Wolf Islander, which several of the divers in this room have visited. The Wolf Islander is on the St. Lawrence River outside of Kingston. She also is a ferry and is a fabulous dive. So there are other examples of vessels reefed intentionally in fresh water. This isn't something brand new. And again, with the best management practices we feel confident that this vessel can be cleaned to the standards necessary. The Artificial Reefs International that I mentioned earlier has had no environmental mishaps in the dozens of vessels that they've sank. Their contract calls for what we call a no-sheen sinking, meaning that there will not be visible traces of fuel or contaminants on the surface of the water when she goes down. At this point, I'd like to turn it back over to JP to give you a thumbnail sketch of what this document boils down to for the Addy.
Okay, well, this document requires hazardous waste mitigation. And hazardous waste mitigation deals with primarily oil, petroleum products, greases, that kind of thing, fuel. The other thing is PCBs, which are chemicals that they use in transformers and electrical insulation sometimes and in electronic components. Asbestos is another item that they're concerned about, and they're more concerned about the asbestos from the worker standpoint in the vessel preparation than they are once it's in the water. And then I think the last one. Okay.
Tough it's to get all of
basically right. Paint. I know it is. Light's not very good either. But at any rate. So we broke it down. We broke it down. You know, oil. You know, to deal with fuel oil and lube oils and that kind of thing. We've taken out every piece of machinery except one that had oil in it. And the bilge pump had a really shallow base, and we were able to clean that. And that's actually kind of a cool thing to see. So it leaves a few pieces of equipment in there, so that the divers will have something to look at. And then paint is the next one. We have to scrape every loose. There can't be any loose paint chips on the boat. You know, if it's peeling at all, it's got to be scraped off. We don't have to remove all the paint because the paint, if it's intact, will actually help preserve the vessel once it's on the bottom. And as far as things like lead is another one. There's about a half a mile of wiring in that vessel that had lead shielding, and we've had to take all that out. And we've taken out actually all the wiring below deck so far, just to eliminate any chance of there being PCBs in any of the wiring insulation. And it's quite a process.
Doors and windows.
Yeah, we have to take out doors and windows. Plastics have to come out. Things like, you know, we can leave the toilets, but we have to take the toilet seats off. You know, it's things like that. I mean, it's that you normally wouldn't think of, but it's quite the project. You know, it's like I said, almost all the machinery is coming out. The fuel tanks are going to come out. Rather than try to clean them in place, we're just going to take them out of the vessel. So just then that eliminates, you know, any questions.
Batteries.
Anything that's electrical is coming out. You know, we've left some junction boxes that are empty and things like that. But any electronic components are being removed from the vessel. Things like fluorescent light valves have PCBs in them, especially the older ones. So you know, all that stuff is coming out. And that's
about it.
That's pretty much it. Yeah, and solids and floatables. That's really the only other one. Can almost see it.
Maybe I should turn the lights back on.
Yeah, I know. But the upper structure is made out of wood, and we're going to have to. It has a rubberized roofing system. We're going to have to take that off because of what it's made out of. And then everything is plank lumber up from the passenger deck up, and we're going to have to strap it all so that it doesn't become flotsam. We're going to have to line it with you know, 1/4 by 2 inch flat bar and screw it down every foot, and it'll be quite a process. You know, the when the boat sinks, there's an air pocket inside, and you can vent it a fair amount, and that'll alleviate that, but you can never eliminate that pressure from inside. And when you know, boards are nailed on and they're designed, the load is designed to be down. Well, it's not designed to be up. So we have to do quite a bit of work just to keep the thing intact when it goes down. And that's pretty much it.
Okay.
Yeah.
One thing I should mention, as John said, a lot of this work has already begun on the boat, like the engines are out, the fuel tanks are out, the wastewater tanks are out, and so on. People may be saying, well, why are they going through all this? The permit's not approved yet. All of this, the things that have happened thus far, would need to be done even to scrap it. Okay, so it's not as if they're jumping the gun and, yeah, we know we're going to get the permit, because obviously that decision needs to be made. However, all the work that's been done would have to have been done anyway. So the timing is right for LCT with regards to staffing and space for the boat at this point in time, so that work has been undertaken. Next slide. John already talked a little bit about this, but it may be a little bit hard to see. Maybe I'm too close to it. It looks blurry. This is obviously Burlington Harbor, we have Apple Tree Point right there. This is Lone Rock Point. Obviously, this is North Beach. This is the proposed site. The proposed site, as John said, is about 70 feet of water. As John also mentioned, we took several different things into consideration, depth being a very important one, but also prevailing winds. Those of you that have boated on Lake Champlain know that it can be an inhospitable place if it's rolling 4 feet. So to sink the vessel out in the main lake, if we could find a spot that was shallow enough, wouldn't be a real good bet, because several days out of any given month, you wouldn't be able to dive it because of the weather. We felt this provided the most lee from winds out of the north, which is this way. It won't be flat if the wind's really blowing, but it'd certainly be a lot better than if it were on the outside of Apple Tree Shoal. We also considered a spot down near Juniper Island, and that is really takes it in the teeth in a north wind. And the lee provided by the island in a south wind, really, that lee dissipates very close to shore because it's a smaller island and the wind wraps around it. So we kind of discounted that spot. Shelburne Bay, great, very sheltered from the north and a south wind, but you've got Shelburne Shipyard, which has, 100 vessels docked there. Lake Champlain Yacht Club is 150 vessels just south of it, and you've got the town moorings for Shelburne down at the very end. It's a very, very busy bay, so we felt that for that reason, that was not an ideal spot. The wreck of the steam tug La Valley is near the mouth of Shelburne Bay, and early on, there were concerns expressed by mariners that it was kind of in a very busy place. So we discounted that area as well. Clearly, you don't want to be in the hustle bustle of Burlington Harbor itself. For all of those reasons, we felt that location made the most sense. Let's see, and go to the next one. Okay, this slide shows, obviously this is the breakwater. One of the benefits also of that site that we proposed is that it's in close proximity to other wrecks of the Underwater Historic Preserve. This is the Horse Ferry. This is the O.J. Walker. This is the General Butler. Right down here near the entrance of Shelburne Bay is the coal barge off Proctor Shoal. So visiting divers could actually, because the vessels are reasonably close together, it makes a nice weekend outing for visiting divers to dive a number of the different wrecks in the Underwater Historic Preserve, as opposed to putting it 20 or 30 miles somewhere else. Another major consideration was the support services available. Obviously, you've got Perkins Spear, the boat launch. You've got charter captains being able to use various marinas for taking charters out. You've got support services like hotels and restaurants and dive shops for the visiting divers. We truly believe, based on anecdotal evidence from the other places that have sunken vessels, that it will be a real draw to tourism in the area. So that's an added benefit and was one of the major considerations in keeping it close to a population center. Let's see. And let's see. One more slide, please. We're getting near the end here, folks. This is an image. When initially we were trying to decide where to put it, things like slope that John mentioned were important. We don't want to put it on the edge of a cliff where it's going to topple down. We don't want to put it on a huge vertical rise. So we contacted Tom Manley, who is a geology professor at Middlebury College. Tom has done extensive multi-beam sonar work on all over Lake Champlain. We got together with him in his office, and he was able to print out this chart. It's over there, by the way, if you want to look at it on your way out, as is the slide JP showed about the history of the vessel. If you want to see those more close up, you can do that. But basically, this is a bathyspheric map, just like a topo map, but in reverse, showing the areas that we were choosing. The color is, as you'll see on the document over there, is depth in meters, the red being shallower, the green being the deepest, and so on. So this general area is in the depth we wanted. The bottom contour, again, not about a 2% slope, so not a big deal. And we felt that it was a good place to put it. Also, other considerations in where to place it were to be a good distance from the public water intake for the city of Burlington. We talked with the water department about that as well. Steve Roy, who's chief engineer there, we talked to him about location, and he did not seem to have any objections with it. So all of those things were taken into consideration. A great map, by the way. I think it's really cool. There is one of the whole lake in top of the, where 3D glasses to look at, and it's kind of cool because you can see the deep trenches in the lake and everything. That's not involved in our project. Okay, at this point, I'll turn it over back over to JP to talk a little bit about physically how we would propose sinking
next slide. Yeah.
In the location we selected, hopefully.
Okay, well, the plan is, I mean, there's a lot of preparation that goes into this. I mean, we've taken a lot of weight out of the vessel. So basically, we would have to ballast it with concrete to get it back to its normal draft. And then we'd actually increase that to the point where it was at its maximum allowable operating draft. So what that does is we would fill it's a V-shaped hull, so the concrete would be in the center of the engine room, just about at deck plate level where it is now. It's about 80 tons. It's a lot of concrete, but that will definitely help it go straight down. Once the ballasting is done, then we have to cut holes in the deck, strategically cut holes in the deck so that the air can vent out, and we want the thing to sink fast so it doesn't have time to turn turtle. And we're doing that under the guidance of Artificial Reefs International. They've been a big help with this part of the plan. And then right before we tow it out there, about the day before, we'll pre-position these anchors. They're 3,500 pound concrete blocks with about 250 feet of line on them, and then we'll set those with GPS, and then we'll get the thing in the center, and with rope falls we can actually put the thing right where we want it. And also right before this happens, we have to cut some holes in the hull above the waterline, like a foot above the waterline. So we cut these holes. We put wooden soft patches over them so we don't sink the thing by accident on the way out there. And then when we get it in position, we take those soft patches off. And then when everything's set and ready to go, we open four sea valves that are in the boat. And that will let water in. They're 6-inch valves, and it seems like that'd be a lot of water, but it's going to take a while for it to sink that foot until those flooding holes are exposed to the water. But once that happens, it's only going to take a few minutes for it to go down. And that's basically the plan. We would tow her out with Miss Piggy, our push boat, which, you know, we used to move all our boats around at one time or another. Her guys are pretty good at it. We don't think we'll have any problems there. And it's got to be, basically, it's got to be on a very calm day. So that's scheduling something like this is always going to be a problem. It's we'll plan for a day, and then at 6 o'clock in the morning, we'll look at the weather, and if it's not good, we'll have to cancel it at 6 in the morning. And it has to be almost a no-win day. In June, we get a fair number of those, so we're optimistic we'll get it on the first shot. So that's pretty much it, yeah.
Okay, next slide. Everything we, I know you can't see this, but everything that we've been talking about basically are appendices to the lake encroachment permit with the Agency of Natural Resources. So all this information can be viewed. If you want to read more on things we've talked about, you do have the ability to do that. The next slide, Wade. So all this information is on the Vermont Division for Historic Preservation's website. And this is the actual website that takes you to the public document that we've been discussing so that you can take a look at it. There is also a survey, a link to a survey on the division's website so that if you have feelings strongly for or strongly opposed, you can respond to that survey, and we hope you do, and put in comments if you do have any comments about it. And one more slide, Wade. Actually, I'm sorry, click on that link if you would. And this is what the website the division's website looks like. Can you scroll down a little or not? Okay. So scrolling down here, frequently asked questions. That's a lot of what we've talked about tonight. The appendices is that big list I just showed you, and all of the appendices are there. You can click on the appendices, and it will take you to the appropriate page in the application that describes it, and your survey. So that's basically our presentation at this point. I want to thank everybody for coming tonight. I'm encouraged, I guess, we'll see, by the turnout. But at this point, I would like to open it up to questions, comments, concerns, or anything else. Anybody? Sarah?
Watch this happen? Are you going to film it? When the sinking actually happens, that seems like a real opportunity to, if it works well. All press is good press, right? I'll put that there.
A little tongue-in-cheek, but Mike Shade and Spirit of Ethan Allen say he's going to sell tickets for the sinking party. So anyway, there will certainly be the opportunity, provided all this goes through. We're not counting our chickens, but yes, we do anticipate there'll be ample opportunity to observe the sinking of the vessel. We actually had a conference call a week or two ago with the Regional Coast Guard Office. They, of course, have to set up a safety zone around the vessel and so on. So there are considerations about that which we need to be aware of. Any other questions, comments? Yes.
Captain. So, you know, I'm PD associates did a bunch of testing on various contaminants, asbestos, PCBs, lead. And my question is, are there any data gaps in the testing of contaminants? And I know you've started to remove components, and, you know, how will you address those gaps?
John, that's a little above my pay grade.
Yeah, there is. Really, the only contaminants that are left, going to be left on the vessel, there is going to be some lead paint. It's not much. Probably the whole boat is less than one downrigger ball. You know, that's about the quantity we're talking about here. And you can't strip all the paint off the boat. It's an impractical thing to do. So that's about the only, I think that's the only gap that there really is.
And my understanding was that the lead-based paint, the only lead-based paint is in the voids of the vessel?
No, it's actually, it's in the engine room, and there's a little bit in the passenger cabin.
Okay. But the hull and superstructure is not lead-based paint?
Right. Most of it's epoxy. It's been sandblasted and painted so many times that there's none of the lead-based paint left on the outside of the boat, on the hull. And the same with the void compartments. They've been sandblasted and painted too. So, it's just the engine room and the part of the passenger cabin.
So now I'm gonna go I was just wondering where the removal of the contaminants would take place, and where the disposal of those contaminants would take place.
Well, it's taking place at the ferry dock at King Street.
Okay, all of it.
Yeah, all of it.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and like I said, we're removing. You know, we drain everything that has petroleum products in it, and then we remove it, and then it eventually goes to a scrapyard. You know, we clean everything, so, and then the we have oily water separators so we can deal with that. Remove the oil from the water when that happens.
One more.
That's all right.
Okay. So I know that ownership would transfer to the state if this were to take place. And I'm wondering, in terms of long-term environmental monitoring or assessments, what, if you have any idea, what would take place? Now I'm thinking 10 years down the road, you know, how do we know? And this is the first of its type, right, this project, so it can really set a precedent for any, you know, future steel boats going down.
Right.
And so just wondering what the long-term plan is.
We have been in discussions with, one of the things we didn't cover in this presentation is study opportunities that do exist. We spoke with Ellen Marsden at Rubenstein Lab at UVM, and interestingly enough, she got her doctorate in creating artificial reefs in the Great Lakes, and not with vessels, but rather with other structure. And she was really excited about the project, and her comments are actually in the appendix, so if you would like to read her comments on it. But she felt that this vessel afforded a lot of great opportunities for studying things, marine life, fish habitat, marine growth on the vessel itself, and so on. So from the perspective of learning scientific information from it, there's a lot of opportunity for it. If you're talking in regards to degradation of the vessel over time, that's a very difficult thing to judge. Obviously, the Lake Champlain Maritime Museum videos all the vessels in the underwater preserve on an annual basis. So there is a video record of what transpires with these. Clearly wooden vessels, or 150-year-old wooden vessels, are in a much different ballpark than we're speaking of. So the degradation of the vessel, deterioration of the vessel, presumably will be a lot slower. Yes.
The maximum planned depth of 70 feet, and it's my understanding that's about the depth that zebra mussels will survive currently.
Mm-hmm.
And so it would appear as though the entire vessel will eventually be covered with zebra mussels unless they somehow naturally get controlled. And the second part of that question is there any kind of a surface that can be applied to make it more difficult for them to attack?
Not in a practical sense. And by the way, this isn't my area of expertise either. I can only speak anecdotally from my experience with the wooden vessels in Lake Champlain. Many of you that are divers know, for example, that the General Butler in the last 10 years has become completely covered in zebra mussels, yet a vessel like the tug, and it's in 100 feet of water, the General Butler's in 40, the tug at 100 has very, very few mussels on it. So you are correct. They are depth related. We do anticipate that the zebra mussels will colonize on the vessel itself. And again, that's an opportunity for scientific study. The presumption is that the zebra mussels like to attach to things with the abyssal threads, and that they're more, they like the hard substrate. So they will attach themselves to the vessel. We'll be curious to see whether there's more on the steel, the iron hull of the steel hull of the vessel, or on the wooden superstructure. There's really nothing we can do about the colonization of zebra mussels. The alternative to eliminate that, to sink it in deeper water, kind of defeats the purpose of the project. Yes?
I think with the other wrecks, you're not allowed to penetrate them at all.
That's correct.
Are you going to be cutting substantial holes in this in a way that would make it a little more attractive to...
Yes. Part of that, and John, chime in whenever you'd like. Okay. Part of that revolves around the big holes being cut in it is to keep the vessel intact when it goes down. Those also are means of ingress and egress for divers and safety corridors, if you will. That said, we will have signage on the vessel, and it will be made clear that if you are not certified to do wreck penetration diving, you should not go inside the vessel. We can't dictate common sense to people. It's like anything, you know, they have to realize that if they're going into an environment for which they're not trained, bad things can happen, okay? So there is the opportunity for penetration diving. The reason it has not been, in fact, that it's been strongly discouraged by the state and the museum and so on the wooden vessels is it does damage the vessels. Also, the vessels are smaller, and the distance between, say, the keel of a canal boat, for example, standard canal boat, 90 feet long, 88 feet long, 14.5 foot in beam, the distance between the keel and the bottom of the deck is maybe 6 feet, and there's 3 feet of silt in the bottom. So if you go into a vessel like that, you stir up a big cloud of silt in a hurry, and also the bubbles do damage to the wreck itself. So penetration of wooden wrecks is strongly discouraged. Steel vessel is a little bit of a different situation. One other comment I'll make in regards to decisions about what depth to sink it. The ADDIE presents a great opportunity to train people at different levels. You've got the roof of the vessel, which will be in, well, smokestack in 25 feet of water. You've got the passenger deck below that, which will probably be 35 feet of water.
Yeah.
Then you'll have the car deck at, say, 60 feet of water, and the screws and the keel at 70. So it affords a lot of different opportunities for training people safe diving practices, and it provides a venue for penetration wreck diving training, which is, there's an interest in doing that. I'm assuming you asked the question because that's an interest of yours? Not necessarily? Yeah, looking in. And for people that are not certified, that's going to be the mantra, is that don't enter the wreck. You know, you can swim alongside the openings and things like that, but don't go in into an environment that you don't have a clear exit straight to the surface. Yes?
Will the vessel remain attached to its positioning anchors, those six anchors, and will those, how close will those anchors be to the water intake pipe?
We're going to remove those. Once the vessel's on the bottom, we're going to remove those. And there's still, the lines are about 200 feet long, and it's about 2,000 feet to the pipe, so it's quite a ways from the pipes. Yeah.
Any other questions, comments?
How many buoys you've been putting on?
We've been discussing that, but two is what we anticipate. And largely that comes to a skill level for divers. For example, we anticipate putting one on the smokestack, which will be at 25 feet, great for novice divers, not to have to go down to the car deck to come back up. And then there'll be an additional line probably put on the car deck. And those lines will be attached directly to the vessel itself, not with separate concrete moorings as the rest of the preserve system is done. Other questions? Yes?
I'm just wondering if LCD has thought about selling tickets on one of their ferries during the season.
Sure.
Well, I'm sure that you
have thought about it.
Thought about it.
For sure. Heather?
We'll see. Definitely consider it.
They're already out. Yeah.
Propellers are going to stay on?
Propellers are going to stay on.
If it says 6 feet in, are we going to see it?
You'll see half of them. Yeah.
Depending on how far the vessel sinks in the silt. Yes.
Thanks again for doing all this. Did you have estimates of how much tourist money this could bring to Burlington area?
You know, that's a real tough thing to quantify. I went on the city of the Plan BTV website, which talks about encouraging tourism to the area, and they have a daily rate that tourism brings in based on the length of the stay. They have an overnight rate, in other words, what visitors generate on a daily or an overnight basis. And really the only thing you can do is kind of extrapolate that information into how many diver visits we're going to have. And that's a bit of the wild card, because most of the evidence in the other locations is anecdotal evidence. There is not a firm registration process where you can say, push a button and say 1,000 divers visited the Wolf Islander this year. So we're kind of guessing. We estimate that, and Chris, correct me if I'm wrong on this, we estimate diver visits on the vessels of the Underwater Historic Preserve now to be in the neighborhood of 1,000 diver visits a year. As some of you may know, there is a registration process to dive the Underwater Historic Preserve that can be done either at the dive shops through paper registration or on the museum or the division's website electronically. That's a voluntary registration because it's free. There are no fees associated with diving the wrecks of the preserve. Although we can see how many people actually registered to dive the preserve, it does not tell us how many people came in their own boats and never registered and that type of thing. So,
or how many dives each of those divers did.
Right, and how many dives each divers did.
I'll answer his question a little bit. As you know, I'm from Maine. I've been up a bunch of times, and I spent a whole pile of money in your shop.
Thank you for that. He's trying to get me shot up here. Anyway, yes.
What does that registration show? How many divers are there on an annual basis in Lake Champlain and those wrecks?
We have about between 200 and 250 people register for the preserve each year. We assume that there are at least that many more that don't register that do dive, and we would assume that each of those divers is probably doing at least two dives. So that's where we come to the number of the dive.
And I can speak from the shop point of view. We run charters beginning in June and ending in October. We go out typically twice a week. Our charter captain's in the room. We go out typically twice a week, one weekday evening, and again on a Saturday or Sunday. And those charters are well attended. People really enjoy it. And we have a lot of visiting divers coming up and booking directly with Larry, the charter captain involved, that aren't necessarily the ones that are coming through our shop. There's a great deal of interest in it. The preserve system is one of the earliest and best regarded preserve systems in the U.S., believe it or not. And the visitation has, the preserve has never been, we don't set up booths at dive shows and say, come visit Lake Champlain's Underwater Historic Preserve. If we were to do that, clearly we could generate a lot more people coming to the Champlain Valley. But you know, that's something to consider. Other questions? Yeah?
I have one more. Does that online survey, which is just one question, how long is that going? How long do you want feedback on that? And is that going to sway any decisions? Like, we're trying to get a campaign to push the people to yes or no on that?
I can answer that. I'm Laura Treishman. I direct the Division for Historic Preservation. And first, I want to say thank you so much to Jonathan and John Paul and the Maritime Museum and Scott, because every time I had a question and sent them back to do more homework, they came with more and more information, which is what they culminated in the presentation tonight. I'm a land girl, so this idea didn't exactly sit well with me to start with, and I had a lot of questions, and that's one reason that we put up the survey. I'm anticipating that we could leave it up probably for another 2 to 3 weeks. As of today, there's 168 responses. 81% of those were in favor of sinking this. So we really, really welcome your feedback, because one thing that's very important to us for this project is your input. If the public is not in favor of this project, then we are not gonna move forward on this. So taking the survey, giving us your feedback, emailing us, reaching out to anybody that's spoken today, let us know your thoughts and your feelings, because we want to make sure that you think this is a good idea and that you will visit the site.
Yeah, what were the numbers? You said you had 160 responses, and I'm just confused. Was it 8% was in favor or 80 were in favor?
So far today, when I looked at it this afternoon, we had 168 responses. 81% are in favor. 14% are not, and the rest are undecided.
And those who are not in favor, what are their objections?
The comments are, we're trying to clean the lake, and you're dumping stuff in it.
And again, that's part of the misconception that we're trying to show here tonight. It's a valid concern. I totally understand it. I get it. We're spending millions of dollars to clean up the lake. Why are you going to sink a greasy, dirty ferry in the lake? But as we've explained, that's not going to be the case. It's going to be environmentally sound and provide a lot of benefits.
We're also setting up criteria so that not every single ferry or boat or anything can be dumped into the lake. That there's set criteria for reefing. It's got to be a historic structure. It's got to be on the lake for a certain period of time, eligible for the National Register of Historic Places. So we're still working through that criteria, but every element of it, the Addy has met.
And I'd just like to add to that, you know, clearly it's somewhat self-regulating about how many vessels you're going to sink, because obviously this is a tremendous amount of work, takes a lot of time. Agency of Natural Resources ultimately has the say on whether it's approved or not. So just getting to this point required a lot of work on all of our parts, and I don't see a ton of people doing it. There also is an expense associated with it to get the permits and so on. And in any event, there are some representatives from the Agency of Natural Resources here, and I would like to thank them. They have been very helpful in guiding us through the process of applying made us consider a lot of things we probably otherwise would not have. So thank you to them. Yes.
Yard or somebody else buys it, it's gone. If you sink it, it's not going to rust in a year.
No.
it's gonna be here for a long time for people to see.
And you mentioned the ROV, you mentioned the ROV tours.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something you can just explain a little bit more?
Yeah,
so?
one of the things we anticipate happening is that some entrepreneur will like to take out people. ROV is remotely operated vehicle, for those not familiar with it. It's a tethered video camera, essentially, like a drone, but underwater. The Maritime Museum, why don't you address what you've done with ROVs?
Yeah, we currently have an ROV program based out of the Basin Harbor campus of the Lake Champlain Maritime Museum, where we can take school groups or other interested parties out to explore the shipwrecks that are in the local vicinity to the Maritime Museum currently. We have a small ROV that, and we typically fly that off of the Basin Harbor vessel, the Escape, which can seat about 40 people and give people a chance to interact with a shipwreck that's normally only accessible to divers. And so it's a great experience for people to see these historic vessels and the wildlife that thrives on and around these vessels. And I certainly think that the Adirondack would be a fantastic addition to that kind of process.
At this point, there are no formal vendors, let's say, for our tours, but we anticipate that to happen. We think it's a pretty dynamic wreck. We're just past 8 o'clock, which was our published, we still have more time. I didn't want to run over, I was thinking 8 o'clock. Any other questions or comments? Yes?
Any feedback from the Army Corps of Engineers to date?
They've accepted the application for the permit, and we've answered most of their questions, I think, at this point. And it's just it'll take another month or two, probably. It'll be probably May before we get a decision.
John, you didn't talk about the AR permit timeline as far as, is there a final hearing on that, or is the hearing already complete?
Misha, would you mind commenting on that question?
Yeah.
Or am I putting you on the spot?
Yeah, no, it's fine. My name is Misha Center. I'm with the AC Natural Resources. I'm the one with the application on my desk. So timeline, I know anticipated sinking date was mid-May. And so in trying to meet that timeline, ideally I would like to have a draft permit put out on public notice end of this month, early April. As part of that public, it's a 30-day public comment period. As part of that public comment period, I will also be scheduling a public information meeting on the draft permit itself. So during that time, we'll be taking public comments as well. Hopefully most of them will be answered in the application and the draft permit itself, but any remaining questions or comments then, we can address in that public comment phase. So
will there be a public hearing?
Yeah, it's a public informational meeting as a part of that 30-day public meeting.
Whereabouts?
Yep.
In Elizabeth.
Oh, yeah. We'll have it in Burlington.
This meeting tonight was not one that was required by the Agency of Natural Resources. It was strongly encouraged to determine the level of pros or cons for the project itself. Obviously, the Agency of Natural Resources works with a, what's the word I'm looking for? A goal of a project being for the public good, okay? And that's what this meeting tonight is about, is to elicit comments on whether you feel it's for the public good or not. They strongly encourage us to conduct our own meeting. The meeting that Misha's referring to is a regulatory obligation. So there will be time for feedback later on as well. Yes?
You guys put in an enormous amount of work, and it's admirable. I'm wondering how much discussion went into the perhaps expensive, but perhaps option that Burlington voters might be willing to do, take
about put it on the North 40, the Texaco Beach, that area, and say, now instead of having a rec that's accessible to 500 people a year, yes, Burlington would spend $5-10 million, put this thing on that land, and have it be accessible to many more people. What kind of discussions were there with the city to pursue that as an option?
We did not discuss that option, to be honest with you. Maybe Heather would want to make some comments. From working on this project, my understanding is that LCT needs to have this vessel gone. The expansion plans that they've been working with, the marina they put in, means that there is no place to put this vessel. The timeline necessary to do what you're proposing would be too long to actually bring it to fruition. It is a privately owned vessel. LCT has the right to do with it what they will. And my impression, again, Heather, correct me if I'm wrong, but my impression is that time frame would simply be too long for consideration.
And the cost. The cost.
This process started in 2017, mm-hmm. and there might be some opportunities to explore where it could have been temporarily located until the city or the city as a whole gets a vote on whether or not they want to put a bond as a percentage on the parks and impacts to fund that.
Yeah, that's a bit of obviously a legislative process that we really did not consider. It's not to say that it couldn't be considered. It was one that, again, given the timeline, unlikely would work. Any other questions or comments?
Would an informal poll among the people that are here be helpful?
I think so. Yeah. Yes. I mean, I know there's a lot of divers here because I recognize a lot of faces. But show of hands if you're willing. How many would support this project? And how many people would oppose the project? I'm pleased with that. Thank you for suggesting that. That was a great idea. I wasn't going to do that, but
you're
since it came from somebody else. Greg?
Sure. Craig Pinkham, I'm an instructor at the shop, and I just want to take a minute and talk about, from my perspective, what the Addy represents as a training platform. But I feel like I'd be remiss, since we talked a little bit about the history of the Addy, to not add my own personal history. I have a very distinct memory. My grandparents had a cabin out on Colchester Point, so my family would spend a number of summers up there. And one of the highlights of the summer was taking the Addy across to New York for no other reason than just to be on the Addy. And I remember one July when I was either 14 or 15, and it was one of those days where the wind was blowing on the lake and the crossing wasn't entirely calm. There was a good amount of wind. And a 14-year-old Craig decided it would be a wonderful thing to sit on the, to stand on the right near the bow of the boat. And, knowing 14-year-old Craig, I was either looking out for a champ or I was imagining myself as the mighty Thor, braced against some unearthly storm. And while I was there, I somehow managed to catch the attention of this pretty young girl who was fascinated by this 14-year-old who was doing this. And she came up and we had this wonderful crossing conversation. And as much as I would love for that story to end with the, "And I married that girl." In fact, I don't even remember her name, and I never saw her again. But that moment burned indelibly into my 14-year-old. So the Addy for me will always sort of have that connotation. As an instructor, when I first heard about this, the realization that I've had working with the dive community here is this is a community that is thirsty and hungry for continuing education opportunities. They want to know more. They want to experience diving through many different vehicles and opportunities. They want to learn, and that's something that we ch- cherish and want to promote among the dive community. And so the Addy represents some opportunity to do, you know, wreck penetration in a safe way. It offers opportunities to have a new platform for teaching underwater photography and photogrammetry. It provides us with opportunities that our dive community is currently going to the coast of Massachusetts to get. So the opportunities that we have to think about how we can promote and nurture the dive community here really are pretty overwhelming. So my, you know, dream and probably fantasy is 20 years from now, I'll have a student who comes up to me and introduces the husband or wife or partner that they met diving there.
We have an underwater wedding on the Addy.
Jonathan, real quick, we have Dr. Mars here, and we talked about you know, how we're going to clean up the wreck.
I didn't see you come in, Alan. Did you sneak in?
So I think we'd be remiss not to get it on record what the environmental benefit would be to having an artificial reef in the lake like this. Sorry, I didn't mean to put you on the spot.
that's fine. The easy answer is that the fish and other organisms, for that matter, are attracted to structure. If you imagine the place this wreck is going to be put in right now, it's basically flat. There's nothing there except sand and silt, which has its own organisms. You put a structure there, and fish will be attracted to it. The interesting question for those of us who work on artificial reefs is always, does that mean there's more fish in the lake because they feed on that and they find shelter and they're protected from predators and they spawn on it? That's called production. Or is it just attraction and there's less fish anywhere else because they're all now gathered around the wreck? That takes some time to figure out. The nice thing about the boat is it the vessel, once sunken, will cross the thermocline, across the temperature gradient, so the higher parts will be in warm water in the summer and the lower parts will be in cold water. And that's, again, like any fringe habitat, it's exciting because you have both sets of fish, the warmer ones and the colder ones. So it will attract fish. I think there's no question about that. And it possibly will actually benefit them by providing shelter and things to, they'll feed on other things that colonize. And of course, the zebra mussels will love it.
Ellen and I had some conversations over a year ago when we first were considering this, and she was very, very helpful and supportive. We would like to set up studies with UVM to do that. Unfortunately, UVM doesn't have the funding at the current time to do some of the things we would like to do. But one of the things I want to have further conversation with Ellen about is enrolling or encouraging divers to do volunteer work about different measurements and collecting data that they would find useful that doesn't necessitate getting funding from UVM. So we'll follow up with that conversation when this project is completed.
That sounds like a really good dive club activity.
There you go.
So I'm Craig's wife, Jen.
Not the same.
I'm not the girl on the boat. I've been on the boat a lot of times, but not on that boat. But we also run a dive club out of the shop. We started it because a lot of times as new divers, you get your dive certification, and then you are kind of intimidated by the divers that are there, or you just don't dive again because you don't know who to dive with and things like that. And so. So we started a dive club, and we're always looking for volunteer opportunities. One of the things that we're probably going to do this late summer is work with the Roselia Project on some underwater cleanups of trash that gets put in the lake, and they do beach cleanups. But I talked with her about a month ago about doing an in-water cleanup of getting a bunch of divers together to do that. So we've done dinners, we do shore trips to the coast, we do a lot of stuff, but we are always interested in activities that involve the lake right here at home. So that's also something that could come about just as a part of this whole community.
If I can add also to Craig's thing and Jen's as well, being a instructor and stuff, slowly over the years we've lost tons of dive spots, especially here in Burlington. There's been no problem throwing a new marina up or something like that, you know, where a dive spot was. And we've literally been whittled down to very few places that we can go diving. And one of the problems, like Jen addressed, was you have all these new divers, but they don't have any place to go diving, really, when they get done. We really are down to Oak Ledge and behind the dog park over here. And some of those are hard to get to, and they're intimidating. And especially the dog park one really only –
we have a, you know, we work through the Parks and Rec Department as the dive shop to get down there. You can't just drive your car down there and go diving. So when you look at it in the end, you're kind of stuck with Oak Ledge Park, which if anybody's been down there lately in the summer, is literally ready to explode. I don't know if you can fit more people in there or more kickball games or whatever, but slowly, you know, I've been diving in this lake since 1982, and a lot of people here have as well, and it's slowly gone down over the years. And like I said, that people have no problem building. You know, we used to go out to Marble Island, and those are all, that area is kind of all gone now because they've built condos and houses and places where we used to go down to beaches. Now it's all privately owned. So having something for once, you know, that the diving community can kind of call their own as well, it's a huge benefit to us. And like Craig was saying, it really is a multi-level, all different types of divers can enjoy it. So I think, like I said, one of the issues we have is like, it's been no problem taking away our dive spots for all sorts of commercial things over the years. And, you know, I think this time we're not really asking a whole lot from anybody.
Things like the name plaques on the wheelhouses we left on the boat when it gets sunk.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering, nothing's been mentioned about money except projected cost. Is LCP paying for all of this?
Yep.
They are.
Can we get together a little fund to pay for the buoys and all that stuff to mitigate that one argument that people have that they don't want any tax dollars spent on this project? Like if you're talking $1,000 for the moorings and the plaque and all that stuff.
I haven't gotten that far. I've been a little busy with the other things. But
just to take one argument.
But seriously, I think this is a discussion that I would have with the division going forward. The division and the state recouping some of the funds that have been expended on the preserve system in general, it may be time to have that public discussion.
If I can put a plug in here to say that probably the best thing that you could do as divers is to make sure you register for the preserve system every year. The more that we can show how many people are utilizing the system and getting benefit from it, the easier it is to continue to maintain it and potentially grow it and things of that nature. So please register for the system annually. Encourage your friends to do so. Even if you don't dive, you can still register for the system. But that alone would be a great contribution to this effort.
I know there are people in this room that would love to see the preserve system expanded. It's very difficult on the limited funds that are available in the tax environment in this day and age. So a further discussion about ways that we can help support the expansion of the preserve program, I think it's time to have that conversation. And I'm happy to try to facilitate that, but ultimately it's up to the folks in the division.
Placing the buoys, it goes to storing the buoys off season, marketing, the website, all the information,
the annual inspections,
the videotaping for the land people and things like that. So it's a very tight budget for us, and adding this to that $30,000 was a concern that we have, and we might end up taking one or two of them offline when this one hits, just for a while, while everyone flocks to the Addy, then we can let some of the others rest for a while while we get more money. And I think exploring with the Maritime Museum and these wonderful gentlemen, federal or other state grant ideas that we can get to do more projects related to all of these underwater preserves and those that are not even online, is something we definitely are going to be pursuing.
Just one buoy?
Two.
One buoy, yeah.
Two.
We propose two.
Two. One buoy, some of you may be aware that we used to have two buoys on some of the wrecks. The reality is the wrecks in Lake Champlain are fairly small. If you get a boat with six divers in it, that's about as many as can comfortably see the wreck without mucking it up for everybody else.
So I used to teach, I used to work at the shop, so I teach there, but I previously was living in the Philippines, guiding, whatever, and then about 7 years ago decided to come and guide in Lake Champlain, right? That's what everyone wants to do. And I get the question all the time, you guide in the lake? And or you teach scuba diving full-time year-round in Vermont, and you previously worked in the Philippines. And I love when I get to take someone underwater and show them the underwater environment that we have in the lake. It's absolutely stunning. It can be a little dark and a little bit green. Just embrace the green, right, Jen? But I mean, photographers have to balance that. But it's amazing what people come out of. They learn scuba diving out of a class, but they also start to appreciate the lake that they used to only see from the surface. And they now know the bass, you know, and the sheep's head that follow you around at Oak Ledge, because that's where we dive all the time. And, you know, they see things, and they see the wrecks and the history. And so I would say divers often are the best voices and advocates for keeping the lake clean, because we actually see it from underneath, and we see what gets deposited there, and we see the quality of the water, and we get the calls to not dive at North Beach when we're already in the water. you know, when they're like, ah, too much E. coli, right? Oh, great, right, okay, we'll wait. So, you know, so we really do care about the quality of the lake because we're in it. So I'd say, like, you know, the community as divers and lake goers, sailors, whatever, we are definitely like the number one advocates for lake quality. And I love sharing that with people, maybe, you know, helping them explore that as an instructor. So I just wanted to share that because that's like one of my big passions of coming back to Lake Champlain, becoming a freshwater diver.
Thank you.
Yeah.
We're out of time now. This is real time. I'll speak for myself, but we're happy to stick around afterwards if you have questions or comments. We'll stay here afterwards. And again, you're welcome to look at the full-size version of the map I showed you. And thank you all very much for coming. We appreciate it. And we hope it comes to a few listeners.